What's going on, guys? It's your boy Ethan. Hope you're having a great day. Welcome back to another video on the channel, and I'm wearing the same Red Sox sweatshirt that you guys have seen for like 3-4 videos on my channel now. Hopefully as spring comes you'll see a different side of my wardrobe, but no promises. You never know. I guess I just kind of wear the same things at home, so whatever, just deal with it. All right, I'm just repping my team. But I guess a couple announcements before we get into today's video and hands and stuff. One, if you're interested in playing online poker, me and my friend have this club that we play in on PP Poker. It's an online app. Feel free to look it up. But if you're interested, email me below. I mentioned it a little bit in the ending of last video, but for people who didn't watch that far, just want to make a small little announcement, email me. If you're interested in playing online poker for real money, it's pretty easy cash outs and all that stuff, so you'll get more deets if you're interested. Secondly, this upcoming week will be a two video week, so I will be posting another little thing probably Friday, Thursday, something like that. I don't really know yet, but definitely be on the lookout for that, because I'll be posting another video. Trying a different little thing that I can do to make more videos and create more content for you guys. Hopefully you guys enjoyed that. I'm not going to spoil anything of what it is, but there will be a second video coming. And besides that, that's really all I wanted to say. So let's get into the hands. Hopefully you enjoy. If you're new to the channel, subscribe. I post videos every Monday, and sometimes I do two videos per week like I am this week. So be notified of when I upload new videos. So feel free to subscribe, hit that like button, because I really do appreciate all the support and the comments below and stuff. So let's get into things. Session, I sit down with, I think, 500 to start. I'm on a very rec heavy table. I think it's like a Friday night or something, and there's a lot of action going on, and it's the table you want to be at for sure. There's a decent amount of money, and also there's a brand new player, first session of him playing poker as well. So very interesting dynamics, rec heavy, so it'll be a good time. I'm hoping for a good time and get into some spots and get mixed up here. So first hand here, I have King Jack offsuit in middle position with about $600 in my stack, and there's an under the gun straddle. So there's two limpers to me. I decide to make it $25, and the button cold calls, and the limpers call as well. So we are four ways to the flop of 10-8-4 rainbow. Action checks to the button. I decided to check, just didn't really feel like c-betting into three other people when I have king high. Who bets $25, and it folds to me, and for $25 with two overs, it's so much in the middle, I'm definitely forced to call on this spot. The turn is a lovely card to king. I check, he bets $35, and I just want to keep him in there, thinking I'm sure I have the best hand, and I decide to call. River is another king, so you go runner trips, which is probably the best runner I could ask for. I check again. I'm assuming he's going to c-bet a lot of time. Given his shorts, he's about $100 total. I think I definitely could have led out here a lot of the time, but just wanted to keep all his bluffs in range if he does have any, or just, you know, have him keep firing with a 10. He bets 50, which is half of his stack, and it's a pretty easy decision for me. I will jam, and he quickly calls with king 10. So that was not what I wanted, actually. Definitely probably like the only hand that really beats me is king 10, and he has it, so we lose that one, unfortunately, but it's all right. Second hand, I have pocket sixes in the small blind, and there's a button straddle on board, so I'm first to act. I decided to open it up to $15. It's a fairly small raise, especially with the straddle, but didn't feel like limping in this spot, especially being first to act. So I open a 15, the big blind, and the button call. So we're only three ways to the flop of 7-5-8 with two spades on the board. Honestly, probably one of the better flops I could ask for with pocket sixes. I'm open-ended. We got some backdoor straight flush draw possibilities and all that stuff. So I decided to check. I think I should c-bet this a lot of the time, especially when the action checks all the way through. The turn's a 7 of spades, so now I actually have an open-ended straight flush draw, and I think I'm a little too strong to just check again. I gotta put some money in the middle, and I bet $15, pretty small, and the button calls. River is the 4 of spades now, so I get there. I get to the straight flush. I'm praying he has the ace of spades, having the nut flush there, and I bet $20, and he folds ace 8. So I get there with the straight flush. Unfortunately, it didn't qualify for a high hand because I needed both my cards to play, and I got no money. So I played that pretty poorly. If I c-bet that on the flop, the I guess the pot gets a little bit bigger and I get more. He definitely would have called with top pair, top kicker, but that's not, yeah, that's just not great. I just played that bad. Next, I have queen 10 offsuit in middle position. There's two limps to me. I make it $15. I'm opening up my opening range just a little bit here, just trying to get involved, trying to force people to make some decisions, especially when it's super rec heavy. The brand new player calls, which I love. I won't really want to get involved with him, and the two limpers call as well. So we're four ways to the flop of queen 7-4 with two spades. It checks to me with the spader on there, just trying to charge the maximum, kind of. I bet $45, and only an early position player, and he tank calls. So not really the best, I guess, call there. I don't know, maybe he's calling with the middling pair or just the spade draw. The turn's a 10 of spades, so I improve the two pair, but the draws get there. He checks to me, and even though I improve, I check it back, just afraid that he has that flush. The river is a 10, so that's beautiful. He leads out for $35, which is amazing, and he only has about $108 behind. So in this spot, there's really not much I can do. I guess I Hollywood just a little bit and then decide go before I go all in. And he quickly folds, which really doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me. I was praying he would call with the flush there, just to convince he had a flush, but I guess he didn't at that time, and I scooped that one. Next hand, I have ace jack suited in middle position. No straddle this time, unfortunately. But my right opens it up to $15. I think about 3-betting here. I think I 3-bet here a lot of the time, but I was being friendly with the guy and I was talking with him, so I just wanted to be friendly, and I decided to just flat call, and four other people call behind, so that's my fault for not 3-betting, because now we're going six ways to a flop, which is never ideal. You never want to go six ways to the flop, so I think if I 3-bet that, then at least it goes heads up or something, or at least three ways. Who knows? But the flop comes jack, deuce, four with two hearts out there. Flop top top on a flush draw board, and it checks to me, actually. The player on my right checks. I decide to make it $60. Gonna charge the max for draws here, actually, and really just bet pretty big. The small blind calls, and my right tanks for a decently long time and decides to call as well. So I eliminate the field a little bit. We're still three ways to the turn card, which is a three non-heart. So when it checks to me again, I think about a couple different things. I mean, when the small blind cold called, I don't really love it. I don't think he's the type of player that will chase draws for a horrible price, so when that happens, I feel a little fishy, but I decided to size up really big and bet 225. And I think this is a mistake sometimes, because I think it folds out all the flush draws, which obviously I want flush draws to call. And also, anything on such like a weird board like that, like I maybe only get like middling pocket pairs to call, but also anything better as well. So when I bet 225, the small blind ends up calling with only $80 behind. So he's just committing his entire stack to this pot, and I am feeling pretty unfortunate there, because I feel like I'm beat a lot of the time once he calls, maybe with a set or something, but still, like, I'm too strong to just check it back, or maybe I could have bet a little bit smaller, but that's how I felt at the time, and it just didn't feel right to me, and my right ends up making the fold. The river is a 7, another non-heart card, so the flush draw bricks out. He checks to me, and there's really no reason for me to bet $80. He already committed all his stack, and if I don't think I'm good here, what's the point of me punting off $80 that I don't need to? So I check it back, and sure enough, he has bottom set with pocket deuces, and the player on my right ends up folding ace-king of hearts. So I was charging him the max for draws, and I wanted him out of there, obviously, but definitely just drawing dead on the turn there when I bet such a large percentage of the pot. When I look back at it, it's interesting. I mean, I'm repping a really strong hand, obviously, and anyone that calls is either drawing to the hearts, which is kind of stupid. I think I should have bet maybe sized down to like a 150, 180 sizing, but at the end of the day, we ran into a set with top pair, but I guess we'll move on. Next hand, I have pocket eights in the cutoff. My stack has dwindled down, unfortunately, to around 250 after that last big hand that I lost. So middle position player raises to $15. Player on his left calls, I call, and the button call as well. So four ways to a flop of 864 rainbow. Top set and a rainbow board. Kind of draw heavy-ish if someone has like 9-7 or something like that. But the middle position player c-bets $25, and I am the only caller. The turn is the 10 of clubs, which is not really the most ideal card, but it's all right, I guess. He bets $60, and I have about 200-ish behind, a little bit more than that, and I could very easily jam in this spot, I feel like, and just rip it in there, just trying to rep something. Not really sure, maybe, I don't know, just trying to get flush draws out of the way too, but at the time I just didn't feel like he was on a flush draw. Maybe he was pretty static with an overpair or something like that. For all those reasons, I decided to call, and the river is the 9 of diamonds. He checks. Obviously it's a terrible card. It puts 4 to a straight out there. Any 7 beats me. And I still have to bet in this spot because I think I can get a lot of value from hands like aces, kings, queens, and jacks to a certain degree, and definitely jacks too. So for all those reasons, once again, I bet $75. I down bet considering the size of the pot, and he calls, and I show my hand, and I'm good. I think I might have been able to get max value if I shoved on the turn, but once again, that's just how I played it. I think I played it fine. I'm actually all right with my line there. Just that river card kind of killed some more action. This next hand is fairly interesting. It gives some backstory to a feature hand that I'll talk about later on, but here I'm in middle position with pocket tens, and there's a button straddle. There's two limpers to me. I make it $25. The player on my left cold calls, and another player two seats over, so I guess she's in late position. She three bets $75. Folds all the way back to me, and I can go one of two ways. I can call or four bets, but with pocket tens, a fairly vulnerable hand that just wants to see a good flop, and to a fairly small three bet as well. It's kind of weird. So I decided to just call for 50 more, and the player on my left folds. Right in this instance, we're heads up to the flop. She only has about $140 behind, so we're either gonna get it all in one way or another, in my opinion. Then the flop comes queen 7-6 all clubs. I check out of position, and she checks it behind as well. So I'm drawing to a 10 high club draw, not thinking I'm really good ever in this situation. The turn is a 5, so another brick, luckily non-club. We both check as well, so I thought about leading, but I didn't want to get check raised or get raised at all. So for those reasons, once again, I checked, and once she checks it behind, I think I'm really good in this spot for any river card, besides maybe like ace king. I'm thinking she has probably ace king. So when the river's a 7, the flush draw bricks out essentially, and I think I'm good. I bet $5 into this pot. I think I can get some value if I bet a ridiculously small amount. So she calls for $5, obviously, and I show, and I'm good. So it's weird because the only hands I could possibly beat her on is probably ace king with the ace or king of clubs, which is the only line that kind of makes sense in this spot. But it's weird because I've seen her three bet with ace deuce of clubs, and later on I also saw her play like king five suited, queen three suited, jacks x suited, just pretty much like paint cards and ragged, like king rag, if that's even like a thing, king and queen rag, but they're suited. So she plays them and calls for the flush draw and gets there, and she's shown that hand many times. So it's weird to put it on a hand that would make sense, but I took that one down, and that all that information is going to come fairly helpful later. This one is a fairly big one. Just a spoiler, I have king 10 offsuit on the button with an under the gun straddle. Three limpers to me with a vulnerable hand, hoping to just take down all the dead money in the middle. There's like $20 in the middle. I decide to make it $30. The big blind cold calls, and the player on my right calls as well. So we are three ways to the flop of 10, 4, 5, 2 clubs, and 1 heart out there. So top pair, decent kicker. I think I have the best hand a lot of the time, and I'm just trying to charge the max for draws. So when it checks to me, I bet $65. The big blind, who is a fairly big stack, he calls, and the player on my right folds. So eliminated one player, and I think his range is fairly static, with having a 10, I would assume so, or maybe the club draw, but highly unlikely when he calls $65 into a $90 pot. But the turn is another 10, 10 of hearts now. So there's 2 flush draws out there, flopping trips or turning trips, with a king kicker. He checks to me, and I decide to size up really big here to 175. It essentially forces him to play his 10 if he actually has one, or regardless, I'm not going to make a whole lot of money even if I bet something smaller like 110 or anything like that. So I bet 175, he thinks for a little bit and then makes the call. So I think I'm fairly confident I have the best hand in this spot because I don't lose to any boats, and ace 10 is a possibility, but that's really only one combination of hands that beat me. There's only one 10 out there, whatever, regardless. I'm really not afraid of ace 10. If he does have ace 10, that's a cooler and I get stacked. So the river is a 3 of hearts, so the backdoor hearts gets there. He checks, and I decide to jam 346 effective, and he tanks for a long time, and once he tanks for even a little bit, I know I have the winning hand or the best hand in the spot. He tanks and then ends up making the call, which is beautiful. I show, and he had jack 10 for the lower kicker. So I scoop up a really big pot there, which is nice, and we're back up on the session. The last hand we'll go over, I have 5-6 of diamonds and under the gun plus 2. My stack is fairly big. I'm just the chip leader after winning that big one there with king 10. So I open up to $15 with the suited connectors, and I get 5 callers. So I guess that's kind of ideal with what you want with suited connectors. You want a lot of people in there and hope for a good flop. And the flop is, like, I guess above average. It's 5-6-5 with 2 spades out there. Flop the boat. Essentially the nuts. I lose the pocket sixes, of course, but I flop the nuts. Actually, to me, I just check. There's no reason for me to bet here ever. And it checks all the way to the woman in the hands where I had pocket 10s. So like I said, she plays a lot of king rag suited. So when she bets $55 and it folds all the way back to me, I am just praying she's on the spade draw and not just trying to bluff here. And I just hope the spades get there. So that's really my own, like, scenario. Maybe she has ace x of spades or king x of spades, but regardless, I'm praying to God that the spades get there, because there's really only that only other hand that's possible. Obviously she didn't connect with the board or anything like that, or have a higher pocket pair. She 3 bets. So like I said, I call. There's no reason to raise, no reason to give the opportunity to fold. So I call, heads up to the turn. I'm out of position. Turn comes the 7 of spades, the gin card, in my opinion. I'm really loving this spot. I check, obviously. She bets out $100, and she has about 250 behind. I think it's the best opportunity for me to just rip it in there. So I jam, covering her, and she quickly thinks for a little bit and calls. And the river's a 9 of spades, 4 spades on the board. Doesn't really matter to me. I'm praying she has the flush. It doesn't matter, but all the money's in there anyway. So I flip it over, and I'm good. So I stack her, and we ended off on a high note this session here. So won a ton, stacked a bunch of people. I played for a fairly long time, 11 hours. There's actually one more hand that I'll go over, but that's gonna be for the video later in the week. I just felt like this last hand had so much background and so much information behind it that I could fit it to just one specific video, because it was one of the more interesting and weird hands that I've played, and got into a tricky spot. So be on the lookout for that. But I played for 11 hours. I was in for 1100, and I will let you guys know how the session ended when you watch the video later this week. So hopefully you guys enjoyed, and thanks for watching. I'll see you guys in the next video. See ya.